Today on The Perspective with your hosts, Pastor Mike Sherbino and Julie Stautland. You could say David Nurse is cut from a different cloth. While many of us feel weighed down by the heaviness of life, David's sweeping the world with his pivoted mindset, one book and one person at a time. From small town Iowa to one of the 50 top motivational speakers in the world and the author of three so far best-selling books, The Perspective welcomes David Nurse to talk about his latest book, Do It, The Life-Changing Power of Taking Action. Get ready to pivot your game.
Hey, we're glad you're with us today. And Julie, I love the intro that Susan did because we talk about improving our game. And when I think of game, you know, I'm not a basketball player.
You're not.
I'd like to think
I'm
that I
shocked.
Could have been, but that's in my imagination. But, you know, there's a guy coming on. He's becoming like a family on the show.
I know, right?
David Nurse is with us, and maybe he'll, you know, do some coaching with me. I don't know.
With old timers?
Oh, well, man, you didn't have to say it that
way. Sorry.
I'm preaching on anger later on, and that made me angry, okay?
I'm sorry.
Not really. Hey, David, come on. Bail us out right now before we have a fight, okay? We don't want that.
Hey, Mike. Hey, Julie. Hey, just so you know, Mike, like there's no certain age that you can stop learning. So you totally have the potential to be a great basketball player.
There
I believe
go.
It.
There you
Appreciate
go.
That. I'm going to send that clip to some team in the NBA. Okay. Oh. But anyways, all that aside, it's good to have you back. Mm-hmm. Sorry that Taylor can't be here. Mm-hmm. That last show was epic.
Thank you. Well, thank you for having me back, guys. I really appreciate you allowing me to come on and run my mouth with you guys. Let's have fun.
We got another book out.
Yeah. Like,
that's pretty exciting.
Yeah, it is. You know, it's kind of like, you know, you have this project you're working on for so long, and I know everything in and out inside the book. And yeah, it's interesting to see when people give you feedback on it and what they say sticks when you think, man, this has really can help people take more action in their life. And then I get feedback of completely different things. I'm like, hey, well, maybe that's the main point of it. So we'll see what we come up with today. But yeah, it is very exciting and blessed to have this thing hit the Wall Street Journal bestseller list.
Yeah,
but that's all relationship.
You know, I also want to say, I love how you, the title, don't do it. And if you see it, don't quit. I think I love that behind there. And like, that is so cool.
Here's the problem with your book. Okay, there's a problem. I read
you know
stuff
why
like
that,
that
is, though?
And I get pumped and I want to go, you know, just so many different things. And like, I need to leave the set right now and I got to go do something.
Oh,
it's all
my
good.
Goodness.
So what's the premise behind the book? What's your goal and what's your target as you're
Absolutely.
Writing this book?
Great question. So everybody has just imagine where you are today. Everybody has something that they want to do.
Right.
So either where you are today to where you want to be tomorrow. And in this gap, this valley below is fear, uncertainty, doubt. The only way across that is taking strategic radical action. So Do It outlines the 9 main fears of why we don't take action, why we hold ourselves back. So the 40,000 foot view that I give to people is like, it's Atomic Habits meets the Enneagram with crazy cool Malcolm Gladwell type stories of historical figures from the past who went on to change the world.
Wow.
So there's 9, yeah, right? There's 9 action archetypes. And I outline the archetypes of, this is what is your roadblock. And most of the time, we're not aware of what these roadblocks are. And some of these roadblocks, we can go through all the archetypes or a few of them if you would like. They're fear of other people's opinions.
But hey, back up for just a second, David. Talk to us about what are the couple of the big fears and then a couple of the big roadblocks.
Yeah, so everything in the roadblock is based in fear because we are afraid of the results. We are afraid if we go all in, what happens if it doesn't work out? That's the fear. Some of these main fears are the allodaxophobic, simply meaning fear of other people's opinions, fear of being burned by the past. You've been burnt before, you're going to be burnt again, so you're not going to take action. Fear of thinking you're too young or too old. This is called the inopportune. It's not the right time.
Are you taking a shot at me about being too old? Like, let's just clarify that. Okay.
No, he said it's always the right time. Always the right time.
So those are a few of the main ones, and one that I actually struggle with right now. So you go through these nine, and at some point, you probably relate to them at one time in your life, and you can keep coming back to them as they're not like the Enneagram or a personality test where that's who you are.
Right.
You can continue to change and grow. And one thing I struggle with is the distracted. Mm-hmm. I think in this day and age, there's so much going on. But what I mean by distracted is it's not always the notifications or the social media, but it's the good opportunities keeping you from your great opportunity, keeping you from what your vision is, what your mission God has placed you upon this earth to do.
That's, when you think about that, the distractions, you're talking about, basketball. I'm thinking about that. The other night I saw LeBron James, he dropped just a beautiful three-pointer in, and he kind of does this shake. And I don't know if it's just cool. And then he goes back down the court, and I'm thinking, okay, he's just keeping his focus. He's keeping going. And like you, I find it is easy to get distracted. But there was so much focus there that I'm thinking, I got to ask you this question. How do you get your focus back when you've been distracted? Mm.
That's a great question. So everything is based on self-awareness. It's understanding of what is going on in the moment. Most of us get so caught up with we fall into this next step, next step, next step, next step. So we have to take ourselves back. So one of the main tools that I provide to people to be able to stop in the moment is simply snapping your fingers. So this would be a great one.
So doing something physical then, something that you have to focus on. Okay.
It's a cue. So this is basically a mental cue. This is a trigger to my subconscious that I'm going to stop because I've placed what I'm about to tell you with this snap. Snap stands for stop. So the S is stop. So I stop. Notice. I notice what's going on around me. I notice, why is my kid throwing a frying pan at my head? Why is my boss yelling at me right over my back? Then I assess. The A is assess. Well, how did I get in this situation? What did I do? Assess the situation. And then the P is pivot. So I slightly pivot the perspective and go in a different direction. But it's all based on self-awareness, whether it's you're distracted and you can't focus, whether it's you're fearing somebody else's opinion, whether you're blaming somebody else. Everything that we do in our days, we get so caught up that just being able to stop, notice, assess, pivot is so crucial for our non-stress, anxiety-ridden life we live.
When I think about the archetypes, the nine, out of all of them, and you say that how we can all walk through each one of them at some point in our lives in some different ways, in the research that you did you find that even though there's nine and how we can move and flow maybe in through all of them, was there one or two that seemed to stand out more than the rest that we kind of always fall into or more often than not?
Yeah, great question, Julie. So of the nine, the main one that the majority of people, so I did too much research and more than I've ever done in my life, all these surveys, and the number one fear archetype was fear of other people's opinions. So concerned about what other people think of us that we don't take action based on what they think. And here's the thing you got to understand. When someone says something about you or has a thought about you, we end up thinking like they're only thinking about us when they're in reality probably thinking about us for 10 seconds and then thinking about what they're having for dinner. So we put so much thought on others' concerns when others' concerns are based on themselves and not us. And I gotta give out this stat because this is just, it's really freeing to know this, that there's a stat that 19% of people will not like you just because. They just won't. It's no matter what you do, you can't please everyone. So when you understand that you don't have to please everyone, it's much more freeing that you can take this action towards your
goal. Just feeling it's better that it's only 19%.
Hey, you're in the 81% in my book, Mike. I like you.
But it's so true what you said. I remember years ago, I was overwhelmed by a situation. Negative comments were said about me, and I was still stewing over it, 6-8 months later. And a friend of mine said, Mike, he said, there's just a little subculture in the area where you're living in. the rest of Canada doesn't give a rip about what that person said to you. And I needed that perspective because it just pulls you down like a boat anchor, doesn't it?
It absolutely does. We think that others like are waiting for what we're coming out with next, what we're going to say. They don't really care. You know what people love? The most attractive trait and quality somebody can have when they're so comfortable in their own skin that they make others feel comfortable in their skin. That's
so
the point of you're not caring about what other people think. And I tell this in talks when I'm giving it to companies. So I tell them, hey, I want you to love this talk. I want you to be this to be the best you've ever had. But when I go home tonight, I'm not thinking about you. I know I can stand up here confidently because I have God and my smoking hot wife, and that's all I need.
There you go. Well, listen, hold that thought, David. We're going to take a short break and return to discuss more. Stay with us, everyone.
It's all about taking action, but it's all about taking action and changing when you're already at a good spot. So here's the thing most people don't understand. Change is inevitable, but change when you are at a spot in your life where you think, okay, I'm just going to hang out here. I'm just going to chill at this spot. No, that's going to eventually lead to your downfall, demise, complacency. Continue to change. Continue to grow. One of the coolest stories that can really show you how important this is to change, continually change at the top, the Golden State Warriors. Okay, 2015, 2016, they won their first NBA championship. They're coming off this championship. The NBA at the time was all about throwing the ball into the big man, into the post, near the hoop, score 2 points close to the basket. The Warriors weren't doing that. I mean, they were kind of 1 foot in, 1 foot out. They were shooting threes because they were smaller. They didn't have the pieces. And they would also try to put it in the post. So they're a little bit of a mixture of both. But in the offseason, after they were at the top, after they won the championship, they made a statement that they were going to shoot more threes than they were twos. That's unheard of. That is changing the game, literally.
Hey, we're back with David Nurse. He has coached over 150 NBA players, maybe on how to do that three-point shot. He hasn't coached me yet, but my day is coming. Motivational speaker, author on the Wall Street best-selling list. David, congratulations. That's just huge. And we're cheering you on for that one. That's so good.
Thank you, Mike. And you know what I tell people about that is it's all relationships and friends and people pouring into it because it was the first week. So it's not like thousands of people could have read it yet. It's just people supporting it and the relationships of people believing in me. So it really has nothing to do with me, but...
Well, you obviously, I loved your other book. So the point is you're on track here with something that is inspiring and encouraging people. And we're just excited to see what else we can glean from what's been put on your heart. And that's what's fantastic.
David, you know, you're interesting. We were just talking about, you mentioned the different people that have supported you. Through your writing, what is your heartbeat? I know you want to support people. You're helping people. We use the term coach. But when you think about supporting people, what comes to mind? What is something that you feel that you can contribute best of all?
Yeah, I love that. And supporting people is not just about encouraging and cheering them on. It's also about challenging them. So in my mission that God has placed upon me is to help people unlock the gifts, the God-given gifts they have inside of them. They're holding them back for these reasons of fear, but helping them unlock these gifts so that they can go achieve great things for the kingdom, helping bring other people along the way. So it is encouraging, it is supporting, but just as much it's challenging because Mike and Julie, if I was say like, hey, I'm going to only let you settle for less than what you are, I would be doing you a disservice as a friend. So it's the challenge and support that I want to show people.
We all need that, don't we?
I was thinking on our last program, Julie, you remember the one when we did the marriage encounter. You and Taylor were here. Let's just take a little bit of a sidetrack and help you remember your wife because I know she's away on the set of The Chosen right now. What do you guys do to support each other? And speak to me, especially from the guy's perspective.
Yeah, that's a great point. That's a great question. So from my perspective, it is, now, I know all the things that I have going on in my day. I have all the things that I want to do. To me, they're very important. but knowing that my wife is more important than those things, I'll ask her what I can support her on. And now I have to place that ahead of what I think is most important to me. So it's the continuous conversation and communication of what's important to us and how much it matters. She asks the same to me. I ask the same to her. But how can I push this forward for you? It's not always the just saying like, I'm here motivating her, because a lot of relationships, one side doesn't want to hear the other's motivation or criticism. They just want to hear the love. Like, I'm here for you. I'm here for you. I'm here for you. I believe in you. Mm. So, I mean, coming back to the most important thing of a marriage of all is the communication aspect of it.
Absolutely. Listen, I want to jump back. I had another question for your book. I was reading about the fact that this is a brain science mixed with heart's feelings connection type of thing. And I was wondering, could you explain how the information that you claimed and worked through as brain science, and how that has an effect on heart's feelings in order to come up with these type of archetypes?
Yeah, totally. So the brain and heart are connected, obviously. And I go into the brain science, the neurological science behind each of the archetypes, so that you can see, the reader can see, hey, this is what's actually going on in my brain. Oh, it's the medial prefrontal cortex where I'm fearing other people's opinions, or it's a cerebellum of my dopamine rush that I'm getting. So you see the actuality that's going on in the brain, and it's not just some myth that this is happening to you. And it connected with the heart. So the heart basically means your feelings. The heart, our feelings, want to keep us safe. It wants to keep us out of trouble. That's why we don't take risks. We'd rather take the easy way out. So I'm showing you why you're feeling this way, mixed with why your brain's working this way, to come to the conclusion that you're going to be okay. You can take this risk. You can take this chance, because you know on the other side of it, it's going to have great impact for others.
I think it makes such a difference, having an idea that there are physical things that, you know, that we respond to that affects your emotions. And I know for me anyway, when I have more understanding, it makes it easier for me to try to understand what's all this going on inside of me, so I can kind of remove myself, distance, to make that better judgment, right? This, with all this information, is to help make better judgments.
Absolutely. So even for the example of Mike and becoming an NBA player, our brains, knowing this, our brains mature in our late 20s. But the difference between maturation and growing and learning are vastly different. Mm. There's actually a section in the brain that gets triggered. It's a wisdom section. You become wiser after your 50s, and we don't tap into this in our early 20s. So Mike, just knowing that should give you a lot of confidence that your contract is right around the corner.
Man, I am just pumped right now, just pumped. I'm just going to yell to somebody off set to go get a basketball. And, I'm ready. Bring it on. But that's so helpful what you're saying, though, because we need to understand that we go through seasons, we go through phases, and sometimes we just can't get it all right now, can we?
Yeah, that is totally true. It's something that, like, we look at, like, we want to be, where I said at the start, where you want to be in your future, your vision. You have to have a vision, or you don't really know where you're going at all.
Right.
We all want to be there quickly. But also, if you get there quickly, you haven't built any roots. You haven't built the foundation for when the storms hit, because you are either in a fire currently, or a fire is coming very soon. And you have to build those roots down. And it's encouraging, though, also to know, like, you will make it as long as you don't just ultimately give up. Give up and pivots are different. But if you research anybody who is at the top, if you see that, man, this is where I want to be, I imagine myself being there, research what they have done to get there. Like, we know my uncle who was the Raptors coach, it took him 27 years to become an NBA head coach. Hmm. People see him as this first time head coach winning the NBA championship for the Raptors. And they're like, wow, he got so lucky. But he'd been coaching for 27 years. So it's also very calming to know it's going to take time, but that's okay.
I love that. And I know your first story talks about how, you know, the lady didn't start dancing until she was in her 20s. So we need to hang on to that. Do it. Don't quit.
You know, I'm thinking of your books. We got Pivot and Go. We got Breakthrough. And now the latest book, Do It. David, thank you for being with us today. Always just enjoy the conversation, the banter. You've picked my spirits up. There's hope for me with the NBA. I just got to grow another 6 inches and I'll be fine.
Well, thank you guys. Thank you for having me on and that all you're doing for the kingdom and showing people that there's a positive light out there, that you guys can be, everyone out there can have an impact, a positive impact on others. So thanks for being that light, guys.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
All right. Stay with us, everyone. We'll be right back. Boldly I run into your presence. One of the things I didn't get a chance to ask David was which of these stories of the people from in history that he liked the most. But I know the very first one really, really was encouraging to me as a little bit older person with Martha Graham, who, you know, you think about dancers. Dancers start when they're little, and she didn't start dancing till she was in her 20s. And she fought so hard to believe in herself and to grow this natural gift that was in her. And she ended up being the mother of all modern dance for the whole, you know, 1900s. So, you know, there's always hope for us a little bit older people, and we just have to face our fears and not listen to that negative voice.
It's a great story, but I'm laughing.
Who are you laughing?
There's no hope for me as a dancer. I'm just saying.
You never know.
I have more chance to be the NBA than the dancer.
Okay.
Like, yeah. But anyways, that's going on the base of what my kids have told me and my wife. But I love David, and he unpacked that whole thing for me. When he talked about fear,
yeah,
we're afraid of what people think.
Yeah.
And if I could give a word of encouragement to people, it would be this. I want to encourage you to press on and do it. Do what God has put on your heart to do. Reach for those dreams. Reach for that passion that needs to possibly be ignited in your heart today so that you can fulfill the purpose for which God has created you. Why don't you stay with us? We're going to be right back, and I'm going to continue teaching from the book of James. Have you ever heard of the name William McKinley? Back in 1897, he became president of the United States. When he was campaigning to be president, he was hounded by an impoverished young reporter who continually attacked him. And one bitterly cold night, the reporter, who didn't have a winter coat, sat shivering outside the coach and said, where the future president was traveling, the train coach. When McKinley saw him, he stopped outside the coach and he said, here, put on my overcoat and ride inside with me. Well, the reporter said, but you don't know me. I'm the reporter who's been ripping you to pieces. And he said, I know who you are, and it makes no difference. And McKinley replied, put on my coat, come inside where it's warm. That, my friends, is love in action. That is what the book of James is all about. As we're talking about this road trip of a lifetime, and as we think about the driving analogy, this week we're talking about backseat drivers and the pain that they can cause. But what eliminates the pain is when someone practices what they preach, which is what William McKinley did. You know what? He lived out what it meant to show love in action. James phrases it this way. Don't just be hearers of God's word, be doers also. It's one thing to say, you know, I hear it all, yeah, I get it all, but it's another thing to live out the faith. And so what we're hearing about this week is when he says, beloved brothers, let everyone be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to be angry. Slow to be angry. Should I say that again? Because we struggle with that, don't we? You know, as we look at what James is talking about, There are other writers in the scriptures who talk a lot about anger. The Apostle Paul said, in your anger, do not sin. Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. So Paul realized there was a place for anger. We should be angry at injustice when violence happens. But he's talking about the anger that is deep rooted within us. Oftentimes, it's the anger of relationships. Oftentimes, it's when we allow a thought to fester and fester. It's like a wound. It's like a sliver in our finger, and until we get it out, it just will fester and get bigger and bigger. It's like we need some spiritual polysporin. You know what happens when we allow anger to fester? It's like we get an education. When you graduate from high school, you go to university. And many times it seems like people pick up a bachelor's of anger. Then they go on a little further because they haven't dealt with it. They got a master's in being angry. And then they get the PhD, which is piled higher and deeper, but they get it in that whole thing of angry, of being angry. And what does that mean for you? The reason I'm saying it is that we can allow it to fester and grow within us. And James talks to us and he said, it is just a terrible thing in the whole journey of relationship. Because many times people don't know that you're angry at them. Or it can be somebody in the past that you no longer see, but it's like a bolt of anger that brings you down and it just discolors you. Have you ever seen somebody who's losing their cool? Sometimes the temperature is rising, they get red in the neck, red in the face. We say they get flustered, folks. That's being angry. Someone has said that the measure of greatness is in whether you can handle anger or if anger handles you. You know, sometimes people do the craziest thing when they get angry. Came across a funny story of an owner of a factory. And on one day, he turned up at the factory just to see what the employees were doing. And he saw one young guy that he didn't recognize just kind of leaning against the wall. And he got angry at that guy. I think he's just lazy, wasting his money. And he said to him, how much do you make a week? And the guy looked at him and said, oh, about $300. And he pulled out a wad of bills and he said, here's 300, take it and never come back. And the guy just kind of looked at him and said, okay. And he walked out the door. And then he turned to one of the other people in the factory and he said, who is that guy anyways? And they said, we don't know. He just dropped off the pizza and was just hanging around to chat for a few minutes. Well, that's what happens when we get angry. And the measure of greatness is whether you can handle anger or if anger handles you. We're going to talk more about it in the coming days as we unpack this subject that's kind of painful to talk about, but so important that we get a handle on it so it doesn't destroy relationships. And if you find yourself overwhelmed with anger, ask God to come and minister His grace to you. And He will. He can change you and I from the inside out. He's waiting for that invitation.